Okay, very good afternoon to all of you all. So glad that you all can come and listen to my simple sharing, especially during lunchtime. Although it's supposed to be a brown bag series, you're supposed to bring your lunch in. I suppose it's more like in the Western countries where you can pack a sandwich. I don't think you can pack your nasi lemak or curry laksa here. But anyway, yep. So I'm from the law school, and I'll be talking about this module that we offer for first-year students, which is called the mooting module, right? So first thing is that, what is mooting? I wonder any of you all here know what mooting is or not, or you have heard about what mooting is? I think most of you all do have heard about it. Well, is it just about wearing suits? Well, because the students will have to dress up as lawyers when they do the mooting. And sometimes we think that mooting is something like a debate. Well, in a sense, yes, you are going to be debating some legal issues. Is it some sort of a play acting? And yes, to a certain extent also, because the students are actually acting like they are practitioners. They're actually acting as if they are lawyers in court. Now let's take a proper definition of the dean at that time. Our dean, Dr. Rajeswari, insisted that we make it a compulsory component, and University of Reading said that they have no problems with us putting that in. Now subsequently, when we started our own Taylor's Law program, this was in 2012, mooting is a compulsory module. It's a module itself which they have to pass in semester two. This is during their first year. So some people have already asked, why are we offering it at the first year? Do they even know enough in the first year to actually start mooting, right? But in my experience, actually, I found that it is actually a good time. And we have had first-year students who actually represented the school and actually represented Malaysia overseas before international moot competitions. Now, the moot problem that is given to the students are based on two subjects which they have covered in semester one, namely contract law and tort law. So it's based on area of law which they have learned and they have already been taught of it in the previous semester. Students are actually placed in teams of two. So each team will moot in pairs, and they are actually required to do their own research and come up with their own legal arguments. Lecturers will be around to give them guidance, but most of the time the lecturers will just maybe guide them, but they will not be helping them in their submissions because they are supposed to prepare on their own. Now, the students also utilize online research because for us in the law school, we have access to LexisNexis and we have access to Westlaw. These are online databases, and the students actually go online and they do research and find relevant cases which they can use during the actual moot itself. However, they are not left on their own from the very beginning. The whole module, actually, there are some lectures, and what we do is that we actually go through some of the skills which are needed, what they need to have before they actually can start mooting. So some of the things that we will talk about or teach them is that they need to develop their public speaking skills. They need to be flexible, right? Now, mooting is not just going and giving an oral presentation. It's different from that because there's a panel of judges before you, and the judges are actually required to stop the mooters, just like in the actual court of law, stop them and ask them questions and challenge the strength of their case. So the mooters have got to be very flexible. They may be submitting on a particular area, and the judges say that we're not interested in that point already. We think that's weak. We want you to talk about this point instead. So they have to be very flexible. They must make sure they are able to change lanes without causing a major accident. And this all boils down to being able to think on their feet. So this is something which we always emphasize to the students. You're not going there to give a speech or oral presentation. You are there to actually persuade the panel of judges. Therefore, they need to be able to look at the problem at different angles. At the same time, they need to show good composure, right, under great pressure. So they are just there, and they are standing before the panel of judges, and they are supposed to answer there and then. They cannot, like, can I take a few minutes to do research on it? So one of the things that they are taught is that they're taught about the art of persuasion. You know, Aristotle talks about ethos, logos, and pathos, how they can actually carry themselves, how they actually use the law, and at the same time appeal to the emotional aspect from the judges. Now, in addition to that, they are supposed to prepare bundle of authorities. Now, this bundle of authorities are exactly the same kind of bundles which lawyers need to prepare before they go to court. And obviously, they need to know how to behave in court. So they learn basic court etiquette, how they're supposed to dress, how they're supposed to behave, how they're supposed to stand up, or when they're allowed to stand up, or when they're supposed to be seated. So in addition, in order to do that, one of the things that we do is that we take them on a field trip. So we go to the Palace of Justice, where we go to revisit the Court of Appeal, because the moot problem is actually based in the Court of Appeal, right? Students have fun going there. But the important thing about going to for these field trips is that they actually sit in the court and they actually see what takes place in the court. So they are prepared and they get an idea, and we tell them that, well, this is what you are going to go through during the mooting exercise. Now, in addition to that, starting from last semester, what we have done is that we have an MOU with a local law firm, Messrs. Tree and Co. And what they have agreed is that they agreed to actually spend time to train our students. So our students not only get trained here in the law school, they are sent to the law firm there, and they actually sit down with practitioners, with actual litigators, and they actually go through the arguments with them, and these practitioners will give them practical advice on how they're supposed to conduct themselves, how they can strengthen their case, how they're supposed to prepare their bundles, etc. So that's the preparation part. Then comes the day of the moot itself. What I will do is that I will get actual practitioners to come. We don't get academics to judge the moot. We get actual practitioners. So some of the practitioners are quite popular practitioners. Even the Bar Council President, Stephen Tiru, has been here before as a judge. Because these are the people who knows what goes on in the Court of Appeal, who knows what is expected of a lawyer at the Court of Appeal, and they are the ones that are going to judge the students to see whether they actually behave and submit in a proper way that's acceptable at the Court of Appeal. Now, what will they be judged on? There are a few aspects. First is obviously the knowledge of the law, 30%. Next would be the application of law to the facts, 25%. The other big chunk of marks, 30%, would be the ingenuity and ability to answer questions. So the students know that they cannot just go up there, prepare a speech, and just read out their speech. They have to be ready to answer questions thrown to them from the bench. And then 10% will be on their style, poise, courtesy, and demeanor. And finally, 5% on their time management and organization. Each team is given only 40 minutes to submit their case before the panel of judges, right? So altogether, comes out to 100 marks. On the day itself also, the law school has invested in actual lawyer robes so that they can actually not just be lawyers, they can feel how it is like to be lawyers. And then they actually go and submit before the panel of judges. They are no longer students on that day. I always tell them, you're going to be advocates and solicitors of the High Court of Malaya. So the strength of their case will be tested. Judges are told to actually push them to, well, at least to the limits expected from a year one student, test out the strength of their case, ask them questions, make sure that they are able to defend their cases, their arguments. And well, this is the experience that they go through, how it is like to be a real lawyer in court. After the exercise, they are expected to reflect on their experience. So that's basically what mooting module is conducted, how it's conducted in the law school. So tying it in with the TGCs, now the first and foremost would be, the most obvious one would be discipline-specific knowledge, able to put theories into practice. So the semester before that, they've already learned the law on contract and the law on torts. Now they're given an actual case and they have to put it into practice. How are they going to apply the law into practice and help their client in the case before a panel of judges? In addition to that, they need to understand the ethical issues as well as understand the professional practice. So not only do they need to talk about the law, they need to know how to behave as a lawyer, right? How they're supposed to address the court, how they're supposed to address their learned friends opposite. They don't call them, my opponents, the other side, right? As we see during debates, sometimes debates, they can be quite funny how they refer to the other side. But in the court of law, you're supposed to refer to the judges respectfully, also to the other side. You must disclose your case. Now, there's something which which students sometimes they don't understand, but that's how it is in Malaysia and in the UK. You're supposed to disclose your case to the other side beforehand. Show your cards. What are the cases that you're going to refer to? What your arguments are going to be like, right? The whole idea behind this in practice is that we try to minimize going to court. Going to court is actually the last resort. Although, you know, in movies, going to court is the best part, but a good lawyer actually tried to minimize going to court. Because when you go to court, in real life, in practice, this is my experience, nobody really wins. The real winner are the lawyers, because you go to court, whether you win or lose, you get paid your legal fees, right? But not for the clients. So these are the things that the students have to learn, and they actually understand through this simple mooting exercise. Now next, interpersonal skills. Because they have to work in teams, and it's surprising that although it's just two people working in pairs, sometimes they face a lot of difficulties and problems, even though they are actually allowed to choose their partners at the beginning of the term, right? They are not allocated, although sometimes we do wonder whether should we allocate them or not, because in real life, you don't get to choose your partners or you don't get to choose your team. But they're first year students, so we say that you choose whoever you want to work with. But even then, they realize that it's difficult working together, although they are submitting on separate issues, but their arguments are supposed to come together as one. And somebody will normally has got to take the leadership role. And it's good to see that usually in the past, I leave them as they are, and someone will actually step up and say that I will take the leadership role in this team, and I will tell you what to do, and we'll tell each other, and I will lead in the arguments. Now you see that this will also help out in the lifelong learning, because they learn independently and they're able to locate, extract, synthesize, and utilize information effectively, be intellectually engaged, and also, of course, in thinking and problem-solving skills, because at the end of the day, that's what they're supposed to do. They're given a problem and they're supposed to solve it legally. Now, digital literacy, yes, to a certain extent, because they need to do the online research. Maybe not as much as what some other schools do, but at least the level of digital literacy expected of a practicing lawyer, right? Which isn't very much, but in these days, at least doing online research is going to be very helpful for the lawyers. Now, because they are also left to come up with their arguments on their own, also the intrapersonal skills can be said to have been achieved to a certain extent, and citizen and global perspectives. When doing their research, they need to actually be aware of the different kinds of views. So although the case is based in Malaysian court, students have actually done research and found cases from the United States, from Australia, although it may not be binding, but can be persuasive, right? So they use all these views and try to persuade the judges that this is how the outcome is supposed to be based on these cases. Now, as mentioned, the students are judged based on these five aspects. And you can see that they're actually judged on whether they have achieved the Taylor's graduate capabilities to a certain extent, knowledge of the law, application of law to the facts, which is the problem-solving skills, ability to answer questions is communication skills, style, poise, courtesy, demeanor, discipline-specific knowledge, and also communication skills, and of course, the intrapersonal skills, time management, and organization. Right, 5 minutes. Okay. There was one semester where I asked the students to come up with a personal video as a reflection. So we're going to watch that video.
Hi, my name is David. I'm basically supposed to share my experience throughout mooting component this semester and what I've learned from it. A mooting is basically the oral presentation of a legal issue or problem against an opposing counsel and before a judge. Going into this mooting subject, I really didn't know what to expect. I had never taken part in a moot before. I had seen videos of moots on the internet and even been to the court to see what it's like, but I really didn't know how it would be like at the end of the day. I think it's really great to have been given the opportunity to participate in the mooting, as many law schools do not have this subject. And to me, I felt that being able to participate in the moot was a really good experience and would serve as useful exposure to the legal profession. We learned various aspects of mooting throughout the semester with the assistance of our mooting lecturer, Mr. Mahon, and learn things like what exactly music was all about, how to speak calm and confidently. We learned the various values that would be required of a successful mooter, such as thinking on our feet, the art of persuasion, having a good understanding of the law and court etiquette, which did come in very useful during the moot. All these things that we learned throughout the component not only served useful during the moot, but these are values and skills that we learned that would be useful in our everyday life, especially in pursuing our legal careers. Skills such as the ability to speak, staying composed, and managing our time well most definitely will come in useful to every law student, not just now, but also in the future when we actually become lawyers. Preparing for the moot was not easy. It took a lot of effort, hard work, and teamwork, especially in the preparation of the bundle of authorities. You will definitely need to work very hard with your moot partner and work together as a team when preparing for the moot, and try to do your best, and most importantly, don't give up, especially when doing research, as it can take a lot of time, but with the right attitude and mindset, one can definitely persevere through it. We had a mooting trial a week before the moot. That was very interesting and useful, as it gave us a hint as to how the big game would actually be like. So yes, it was really great to have been able to do that. These essential values that I learned in preparing for the moot, such as being patient, working hard, and never giving up, not only served useful in preparing competently for the moot, but these are life values that I will be able to take with me as I move forward in my legal studies. It was pretty nerve-wracking, actually. I was doing the talk lesson at 9 a.m, which was the first session, in front of a pretty good panel of lawyers, so it was a lot of pressure at first. I was the junior appellant, so I had to speak second in the moot, and I was also doing the rebuttals on behalf of the appellants. So yeah, to be pretty honest, I was kind of nervous as to how the moot would turn out. Throughout the moot, yes, it was hard. A lot of unexpected questions were raised, and it can be difficult at times to maintain your composure and court etiquette during these tense moments. But nevertheless, I think it is a really good experience, and I'm really glad to have been able to do it. I think the key to becoming a successful mooter would be having that dose of confidence and speaking well, and just knowing all the facts, because once you have all these elements in your hand, hence, it's evident that you've done all your hard work and you're ready to win this moot. I think every person should go into a moot just being prepared and just be confident with your responses to questions and with your speech. Just do your best. I believe that many of these essential values that we learn from this moot, with the most important ones being just being confident, teamwork, and hard work, will definitely serve for school in our future undertakings as lawyers. And it's really great to have this experience to be able to participate in this group. I think the best part of the group was the experience that I learned. Great exposure to the legal world of how it would be like, car. And of course, most importantly, just doing your best and never giving up, because it is a learning experience after all. And yes, I would most definitely love to do it again.
So you can hear from his simple reflection, although he didn't refer specifically to the TGCs, clearly references were made to it, like communication skills, interpersonal skills, where to work with his partner, intrapersonal skills, where you know he had to really dig in and really work hard in it and work and depend on their own abilities. right? And of course, lifelong learning, things which he felt he learned, which will be useful for him when he actually goes into practice in the future. Now, we have also asked them to write out their reflections lately. So usually in the reflections, we ask them to specifically talk about which of the TGCs have they managed to achieve. And they usually talk about how they managed to achieve, you know, almost all the TGCs, right? Discipline-specific knowledge, thinking and problem-solving skills, intrapersonal skills because they have to be self-reliant, interpersonal skills because they have to work with their partners, understand the team dynamics. Communication skills is, of course, very important. They talk about communicate with their partners also, but also at the end of the day, they forget that it's also communicating with the panel of judges. And lifelong learning, the use of online databases makes them think that they have actually achieved to a certain extent digital literacy. And of course, citizenship and global perspective, having to actually look at the views and the law from other jurisdictions and other countries. So for most of the students, right, the MOOC is just a starting point, right? First step on the fulfilling journey of being an advocate. Even if they are not going to be practitioners, at the end of the day, they're not going to be lawyers who go to court. Wherever they are as legal advisors, all these skills will be useful to them. Interpersonal skills, intrapersonal skills, communication skills, and discipline-specific knowledge, problem-solving skills. So students, well, most of the students now, they have been called to the bar in the UK or in Malaysia, and some of them are already in practice today, and I hope that they are putting what they've learned into practice, and of course, it's still going to be a lifelong learning process for them. So that's it for my sharing today. I'm open for any questions.
Let it be medicine, let it be law, it is always something which is a guru-guided study, a one-to-one study at the end of the day. Somebody teaches me, I be with that person for a long period of time, and eventually I learn the techniques from him and then start to practice whatever it is. So we all have been struggling to achieve that point of early attachment, early exposure, maybe for you it's clients, for us it is patients and so on. So you said this mooting experience is all about year one. So how you keep the knowledge under the bar of year one when you want to achieve a certain goal which is very specific about, you said 30% for knowledge of law. But when we discuss a case of law, a client's case, it's a full-fledged case. Say for example, it's a case about some murder or whatever it might be to me as a layperson. So then how you keep it under the, because they are not truly exposed to knowledge at that point. So how you make sure that you keep it under the bar that, yes, that's your level one, year one. So is there any criteria or how you take that? You know, because many things are not known at year one. So how you achieve that?
Okay, thanks for the question. Actually, I take a very easy way out. I get the lecturer who has taught them in semester one to actually help to draft the MOOC problem. Because it's going to be based on what they've learned in semester one. So he will draft the MOOC problem, although it's like a court case, but the MOOC problem will be only focusing on the specific issues which have been covered in semester one, right? Although sometimes they are expected to do further research on their own. So that's one thing. First, we make sure that the problem itself is drafted in a way that is actually catered to what they know at that point of time. Right?
Kind of an easy issue, is it?
It's a more focus on the issues which they have already learned in semester one. So whatever they have not learned in semester one will not be the issues covered in that problem that we give to them.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah, and normally, because it is based in an appeal setting, the appeal setting usually is only focusing on 4 points or 2 points. So for us, we just focus on these points on a law which they have already studied before in semester one. Because on top of that, we do tell the judges, please remember they are only semester one students. So please judge them based on the fact that they are semester one students.
Any case coming to the court of law, there is nothing like year one to year five.
Yeah.
Whatever it is, it is just a fully exposed area.
Yeah.
So keeping it under the bar must be a real challenge for you. Keep it at level one. Stop.
But of course, also at the same time, ideally, as a law school, we cannot expect to be able to teach them every area of the law because law covers everything. So what we hope to at least impart to them is the ability to be able to understand the law and interpret the law and apply the law. Because when they actually take part in international moot competitions, it's going to be on areas of law which they have not studied before. And they actually got to start from scratch, know how to research, find out what the law is, understand it, and apply it to the facts.
Any further questions from the floor?
I have a question for more like I want to understand the overall picture. You see, you have got a module for mooting, but I have the understanding TGC is about incorporating it throughout. It's a process. It's a learning process. So from the day we step into TLS, right up to the last day, we're going to incorporate this program, cultivate and develop that. So having a module is very good, it's an awesome way to introduce them, prepare them for the world outside. But how else does a law school incorporate this in every module to ensure these elements are captured? In each module, overall, what are the activities you do to capture these elements? Just one mooting, one module is not sufficient, right? So if you could give us a overview on that, that might help us to see where we can incorporate or have a project, have an activity where we capture these elements and how we can implement this TGC. I think that would be quite vital for us. I mean, it will be a good take home understanding, I would presume.
Okay, right. Thanks. Mooting is actually our showcase. Yeah, so we do actually incorporate the TGCs into all the other modules, which is the more, well, should I say, more boring, straightforward kind of modules, right? So how do we actually see whether they have achieved it or not? It's usually, some of it are through traditional methods like tutorials and examinations to see whether they have got the discipline-specific knowledge, problem-solving skills, and then communication skills through how they actually answer the questions, how they draft the questions out. We have got assessments like coursework, writing essays, oral presentations, video presentations. So this is actually incorporated throughout the different modules. So some modules may have video presentations, some will have oral presentations. Some will have group presentations. So these are how we actually hope to achieve things like interpersonal skills, intrapersonal skills, communication skills, problem-solving skills, citizenship, and global perspective. What is my take on this flip teaching?
Because that is one way which is the current trend from teacher-centered based to student-centered learning, where they try to incorporate these things.
To a certain extent, yes. We are trying to actually go more into that, experimenting more into that, like problem-based learning. So what we are hoping to achieve, at least in this coming semester, because this was actually brought up, interestingly, by our external moderator, who suggested that maybe we should incorporate problem-based learning methods. Yes. So we are trying to do that. So instead of just coming in and this is the lecture, this is the law on contract, on offer acceptance, we give them a problem first, and then they'll have to actually study and look for the law and see how they're going to answer the question.
It is.
I think it's very interesting, actually, so we're quite excited about it.
Huge area to explore.
I'm not very familiar. Sorry, I've not familiarized myself with the syllabus under the law school yet. But mediation, you mentioned, actually comes as part of the syllabus?
Mediation. Yeah. Yes, mediation is also part of the syllabus. Okay. It's under... Well, we talk about it very briefly in year one under the Malaysian legal system, and also we also have this alternative dispute resolution where mediation, arbitration, and all this are covered also.
So when you have mooting, which is actually a dose of reality in the courtroom, your mediation as well as the situation. Are there any way that the graduates are given experience of that?
On that, sir. Actually, no. When we teach them on this alternative dispute resolutions, it's more of a theoretical ways. We think that going to the court is probably the most difficult, the most challenging. So if you're able to do that, then things like arbitration, mediation, is actually a notch lower. So in fact, some of the moot competitions that we take part in is actually based on arbitration. So we actually tell them that in arbitration, well, it's less stressful because you don't stand up, you actually sit down around the table, and you actually talk to the arbitrator like Mr. So-and-so, you don't have to call them my lord or whatever. But at the end of the day, you still got to come up with your arguments in a very structured way and be able to persuade the panel.
Right.
Can I ask?
Are we okay to have one more question? You guys have...
You mentioned that this voting is...
Yeah.
Should I?
Is
the speaker okay? No, because actually I had not planned to, but I got this idea because they're asking about.
Okay.
He's going to a moot court now.
Yes.
You said it's done in semester two, right?
Semester two, correct.
So that's an experience which is done in like end of year one. How about having similar kind of experience in other years? Sorry, I'm not well versed with your curriculum, so I just want to know like. It is only done once in the whole course of law?
Compulsory, yes. That means they are only made to do it once in their whole. If they are interested, subsequently what we do is that we actually train them to take part in moot competitions.
All right. So that's if there is other exposure in the course, it's only with view of competitions. There is no other way by which they practice the same in other semesters?
No, nothing official, no. The other way is to probably through attachments, which they actually, during the holidays, they will attach themselves to a firm and then they can actually follow the lawyers to court. But they won't get to do much there except to maybe just assist or just to observe only.
Thank you.
But as
Dr.
Amaya and Dr. Sapna, the main question I'm asking is, by one semester, how much grave they are in the law? So that they can have a very good moot experience with the application of good amount of knowledge. Because we know that we all of the students struggle in semester one, including School of Medicine. That we have got diverse students, some matriculation, some foundation, some STPM. To get them into the main swing of tellers requires a lot of hurdle. And within this semester one, whatever you are getting and then you are testing in moot, is it not advisable to take this exercise much later in the career, maybe in semester four or semester five?
That is something which is always been discussed. It's always been KIV. Well, we have it in semester two, so I guess that those who are not capable are already weeded out in semester. Now, I think one thing we also need to bear in mind is that our law school here, we actually have got very high entry requirements. So compared to all the other private institutions, I think our law school has got the highest entry requirements. So we generally get quite good students. And based on my experience, having done it since 2008, it's actually quite surprising initially, but no longer now, to see that students actually give a very good, decent performance in the mooting experience. And the practitioners who come in always have very good things to say. Well, most of the time, yeah, they actually are very impressed. But of course, you know, these students have been working on the same case for like three months. So they always say that, you know, some of you actually perform better than lawyers in court, which is true because sometimes lawyers in court, they're only given a case like 2 days or 3 days beforehand only. So they actually do give a pretty good showing. So I think that because of that, we will maintain it. And I think it's a very good experience for them being thrown to the deep end in semester two, in year one itself. And after that, you know, they actually gain a lot of self-confidence. Hey, this wasn't really that bad after all. Instead of waiting and say that, no, you're not ready yet, maybe you wait until much later. But a lot of other universities, they actually offer mooting much later on. Yeah. So we do see the argument on both sides, and it's obviously still something we are going to have to really decide. But at the moment now, it's going to be status quo. Yeah, as long as I'm in charge.
All right. I think I believe that the last question. Thank you again, Mr. Lai Manoon, Associate Dean of Learning and Quality from Taylor's Law School.